The last part for of the topics for your exam three should be very familiar with you. This is polycystic kidney disease. This is in chapter 62. Remember in module one under renal failure, acute kidney injury rather, and ESKD. This is one of the causes of ESRD. This one is a genetic condition that can lead to end-stage renal failure. So therefore, besides management of this disorder, you're already familiar with what a patient with ESRD is. So there will be a few questions reviewing dialysis, both hemodialysis and peritoneal dialysis. Okay, but the concept is the same. All right, so let's begin. PKD is, like I said, genetic. There are two forms here. The patient can either get the childhood one or the adult onset polycystic kidney disease. Obviously, PKD in infancy and childhood is one which the patient develops in childhood. And this one is not very common, so let's go with the adult one. So the adult form is a autosomal dominant type of genetic disorder. It's pretty high chance of transmitting it. That's 50%. What happens is the patient at birth doesn't manifest symptoms of the disorder. Now, the sad thing is it develops around between 30 and 40 years old. The patient develops these cyst filled well the cysts that fill up the kidneys. They are fluid filled. Look at the illustration here. So slowly the kidney enlarges because of the growth of these cysts, and the kidney enlarges to the extent that it is now palpable, like there's a mass growing over the left and right sides of the abdomen. Like I said, these are palpable. They are quite large enough to cause GI problems even. Some patients will develop constipation when the kidneys start pressing on the small, or rather more like the large bowels, the colon. As stated here, they start compressing not only GI organs but also blood flow. The blood vessels to the kidneys will also be affected. Now, of course, you can already imagine what will result from this. Sometimes the cyst will rupture, causing bleeding, and some of that blood may obstruct urine flow. So this would be, you can, if I ask you, will this cause pre-intra or post-renal failure? This type will cause two. First, of course, this is intra-renal kidney failure, because obviously it grew inside the kidneys. However, when these things rupture eventually, because most of these will grow large enough to compress renal tissue, healthy renal tissue, so therefore it will cause death and scarring. Now, as more and more of these cysts develop, then of course the entire kidney will be destroyed, leaving you with just these remnants, mostly scar tissue now. So therefore, and this occurs in both kidneys. So the patient, it's not like this will only grow on one, wherein they can still live and survive on the other. Unfortunately, it affects both kidneys. So for one part, this will result in intrarenal kidney kidney failure. However, if it causes obstruction, especially again if some of them bleed and cause blood clots to form in the renal pelvis, and then eventually it will obstruct urine flow, then the patient will also have post-renal kidney disease as well, or post-renal kidney failure. So just like in module one, the patient therefore manifests, there will be early symptoms, not necessarily kidney ESKD yet. So these are the first few symptoms the patient will have. So there's hypertension, and then you already know what the consequences of hypertension are. This will eventually cause heart failure, other large vascular disorders like aneurysms, for instance. I already mentioned the hematuria as the cyst rupture. Obviously, there's pain over where the kidneys are, back or flank pain, headaches, and abdominal pain. UTI is also possible, as these cysts can cause infection as they rupture. There will, I already mentioned that there's a possibility of stones, so this will result in post-renal kidney failure. I already mentioned that the kidneys can grow large enough to be palpable, which can increase abdominal girth, cause constipation, and then as this again develops, as this advances, the kidney will of course die, because it's now full of just ruptured cyst over time. And you know the end result. The patient will be reliant on dialysis for the rest of their life. There is no other way to prevent this other than not having biologic children. This is quite high, the chance of getting this, the chance of passing this rather to an offspring is about 50%. That's quite high possibility. So part of your nursing care will be, there's not much done to be done with the patient, but at least they can be counseled. You know, genetic counseling will be part of your nursing care here. Diagnosis, we of course have to do either an MRI, intravenous pyelogram. This is the test using an IV dye, or a CAT scan to visualize the appearance of the kidneys. These cysts can also grow on the liver sometimes, or can even affect other abdominal organs. An ultrasound can also show the cyst. Treatment is mostly same as in module 1. So So controlling blood pressure, managing the symptoms like hematuria, if they cause obstruction, let's say there's too many blood clots in the either in the ureter, or they end up obstructing urine flow either in the ureters or in the bladder, then the patient will need large Foley and bladder irrigation in those cases if the bleeding is large enough to cause urinary retention. If the patient's kidney function fails to the extent that they develop uremia, then of course they will be put on dialysis. But other than that, you've seen your patients with who are on dialysis, look at the number of medications they'll be on, will have to control their electrolyte levels, restrict protein in the diet. You have to recall what the management was in ESRD under module 1. Because there are UTIs, they'll have to be treated as they develop. There's pain management in addition to managing blood pressure. Obviously, the pain can be severe enough to require opioids. And if needed, the pain is treated by nephrectomy, meaning the kidneys will have to be removed to manage the pain. They're diseased anyway. So they'll this time, unlike kidney transplant, wherein they leave the, I'm talking about other causes of ESKD, wherein the kidneys aren't necessarily diseased, but this one in polycystic kidney disease, the kidneys are gone. They are pretty much dead, so they can be removed. Complications, pretty much what the same complications that developed in module 1, because this does lead to ESRD, so the patient therefore has permanent hypertension and fluid overload, which can leave the patient with heart failure, and I already mentioned vessel diseases like aneurysms, okay, because of the hypertension, severe hypertension. Then the patient, of course, will require new kidneys. So if they can be fortunate enough to get on the kidney transplant list, then good for them. So these are your other findings now for PKD, which was already mentioned in the paragraph. As far as nursing management goes, as you can see, the management is really the same as any patient with kidney injury, most likely CKD rather than acute kidney injury. So this is more chronic. The patient, of course, develops anemia because you already know the erythropoietin will now be affected. There's weight gain because of the fluid overload. Here's anemia. And urine creatinine, of course, will be elevated. So are your electrolytes. Kidneys slowly lose function until they get on dialysis. So once on dialysis, even before dialysis, they get on dialysis, we'll have to preserve as much of the remaining kidney function as possible. So we don't want to aggravate it by increasing protein or electrolyte consumption. Right, so there we already start protein and fluid restriction even before the patient goes into dialysis. Antibiotics, of course, if the patient develops UTI. And that's it. Let's move now to pyelonephritis. Your textbook only mentions acute pyelonephritis. If you've been on a med-surg floor, chances are you've already seen a patient with pyelonephritis. This is basically the acute form. Okay, again, I'd like to emphasize that this is the acute pyelonephritis. This is basically an infection of the kidneys. Unlike a UTI, by the term itself, affects the urinary tract. So that would be affecting the urethra and or the bladder. Or another term for UTI is cystitis. Now, if that same infection goes up further up the urinary tract and reaches the kidneys, now it becomes pyelonephritis. So one number one risk factor, therefore, for pyelonephritis is a urinary tract infection. So as stated here, the major risk factor is multiple pre-existing UTIs, treated or untreated. Some of the causes are the following, which we will discuss again later toward the end of this recording. The UTI can be caused by either enlarged prostate, which causes urinary retention, and the longer urine stays in the bladder, then the more chance of it growing bacteria. You already know about CA UTI or CAUTI, catheter associated urinary tract infections. Pregnancy, this is of course pregnancy induced pyelonephritis, again because of the changes in the hormones causing water retention, which will affect urine retention as well. And then sexual activity in women, women particularly are you know your high risk for urinary tract infections because of the anatomy, the proximity of the vagina and the anus makes you prone to urinary tract infections. The chronic form isn't caused by the chronic pyelonephritis doesn't develop from an acute pyelonephritis, meaning a patient, let's say if a patient has repeated attacks of acute pyelonephritis, it doesn't become chronic. Okay, so each incidence of acute pyelonephritis is still called acute pyelonephritis. Chronic pyelonephritis usually develops from a structural deformity. So for instance, if if there is a let's say a connection between, so let's say this is your bladder and say this is the So let's say this is the bladder and you have the colon here, right? And okay, all right, that's as close as a drawing as I could do. All right, so let's say this is your bladder. Let's say this is your uterus and this is the bladder right here. Of course, they're separate systems, right? You have the uterus, which of course, well, it would be behind here. So this is your, so let's say this is the vaginal canal and this is your bladder. As you can see, they're separate, right? chronic pyelonephritis can develop if there is a fistula, for instance, an abnormal connection between the vaginal canal and the bladder, for instance, or it could be the urethra and the vaginal canal. So this type of problem can lead to the chronic type of pyelonephritis because the cause is from a structural defect, meaning these patients will of course develop frequent urinary tract infections because of a structural deformity. Because there's a abnormal connection, there will always be for instance, there will be blood from the uterus, for instance, or the bladder is sterile but the vaginal canal isn't. So when there is a fistula there, of course you will have frequent UTIs that will result, or worse, if the fistula is not only between these two, but what if there's another fistula between the colon and the vaginal canal and or the urethra at the same time. So this one will lead to chronic pyelonephritis. So again, a patient with acute pyelonephritis, it doesn't develop into a chronic type of pyelonephritis if the patient has more than one episode. So they are, one doesn't develop into the other. Clinical manifestations of pyelonephritis, think about this is an itis, so therefore it'll be an infection. And like already mentioned, most common cause is a UTI. So therefore, acute pyelonephritis patient will have signs and symptoms, therefore, of a UTI. But unlike UTI, which is in the lower urinary tract, this one, of course, has already gone up all the way to the kidneys. So this is, again, another cause, possible cause of intra-renal kidney failure. And because this is an infection, so the patient will look sick. So fever, chills, nausea, vomiting, and particularly pain over the kidneys as well. And the dysuria and the urinary frequency, or even hematuria. Okay, all signs and symptoms of a urinary tract infection. Diagnosis, of course, will be positive for UTI, so we'll get a urine sample. Not only urine culture, but also blood culture. And the same as in polycystic kidney disease, we'll have to visually inspect the kidneys to see if there is, to confirm that there is pyelonephritis. So the kidney itself, this one can involve a unilateral kidney. Doesn't have to be both kidneys that are affected. So the imaging study, CAT scan, usually will show the pyelonephritis. In some cases, if there is obstruction of urine flow, it may show hydronephrosis, which means the urine flow is severely obstructed, that it will back up into the kidneys. Okay? Yeah, think about it as urine flooding the kidneys. Treatment, of course, this is caused by a UTI, so we will be dealing with antibiotics, obviously. Here are some details, you know, besides antibiotics, we increase hydration. I believe you already talked about UTIs in probably last semester or even in fundamentals. But anyway, we will review them again for this recording, which is in another chapter. Take note that because the patient may have more than one episode, And you already know that this will be treated with antibiotics, so therefore the most important teaching you can have is for the patient to finish the whole course of antibiotics, otherwise it will lead to antibiotic resistance. These are your most common antibiotics. Bactrim is most commonly used. We can also give fluoroquinolones like Cipro. And other agents involve, the other drugs are really also mentioned under UTI, but they're also available here. The patient will also be given symptomatic management besides the antibiotics. By the way, if they're in the hospital, of course, the patient may be given IV antibiotics, not just PO antibiotics. These are the other medications used. We already mentioned increasing hydration. So the patient will be given pain management, either opioids or NSAIDs, Tylenol for fever, and then urinary analgesics. You already know about Pyridium, the drug that, this is for the bladder pain. And you know that Pyridium does turn the urine orange, and that's expected. Cranberry juice, you already know the evidence behind cranberry juice. This is an acid ash diet, which retards bacterial growth. Here, it's an acid ash diet, so therefore it increases acidity of the urine, which retards bacterial growth. And also vitamin C. Okay, but of course we don't want too much vitamin C either, because that will be, especially if the patient shows signs of acute kidney injury already. By the way, acute pyelonephritis can also lead to potentially CKD, meaning end-stage kidney disease, in the sense that if it is untreated or poorly treated, say the patient started antibiotics but didn't finish, then that will be one of the complications. The patient can develop chronic kidney disease as a result, which brings us back to module one again. And surgical management, this one, this doesn't mean that every time the patient has acute pyelonephritis that they'll have surgery. Surgery here is to relieve the symptoms. For instance, let's say if there is urinary obstruction, and if the patient now develops hydronephrosis, then the patient may need, let's illustrate it here. So if the patient's kidneys, for instance, are, let's say the kidneys are here. So if there's now urine inside the kidney, then they will do a pericutaneous procedure. So they'll either insert a needle to drain the urine, or they could leave in a catheter, okay, a drain. This is now called a nephrostomy tube, which will drain urine. Since the urine can't pass down here to the bladder, then they'll have to drain the urine through a bag. Of course, that is invasive. This is done under radiology. So there will be a bag here, which the patient will carry to drain the urine. So that is the surgical management. Of course, if there are stones, then there are several procedures to remove a stone. They have lithotripsy, either by laser or by shockwave, right? And that's in another chapter. Nursing management, because the patient has these symptoms of UTI, we have bladder spasms, we already have the phenazopyridine for that, the pyridium. And pain management, so we have either NSAIDs or opioids. And I leave you responsible for nursing management. Here, please read assessment. You have the rationale here for each action. And assessment findings as well, I forgot. Here are your actions. We already mentioned this, increasing fluids, pain management, antibiotics. And of course, acute pyelonephritis stems from a UTI, so therefore part of your teaching, of course, will be how to prevent UTIs, especially in female patients. Box 62.1, there will be a separate box later. That other box will be specific to catheter-associated urinary tract infections. And this one is for all other causes of UTI. Okay, so these are general, perineal hygiene, for instance. If they've had a UTI, then they have to finish antibiotics. Specify this part here because the antibiotics work really fast and will improve symptoms. It's important that they finish the whole course, okay, and not stop because they felt better. These are practical examples, so please read them on your own. Okay, so sexual activity should be there should be a emptying of the bladder before and after. Okay, so specifically says here before and after sexual activity, and don't forget to wash afterwards and avoid these. Okay, because they change the pH of the perineum and will predispose you for UTIs. Cranberry juice, obviously this will increase urine acidity, and these are early signs and symptoms of another UTI. Alright, that should be it. Let me check. Okay, this one I will leave for pediatrics because most incidents of acute glomerulonephritis is occurring on children. So I will leave this for peds. Let's go now to the rest of the topics. So here is UTI. This should be quick. The other name of a urinary tract infection, as I mentioned earlier, is cystitis. Of course, that is infection now. If the UTI goes up to the bladder, so now you have inflammation or infection of the bladder. But the most important is, of course, catheters. So here is your the box I mentioned earlier. So this is catheter care, the importance of catheter care. Joint Commission core measure states that under SCIP, which is Surgical Care Improvement Project, in surgical patients, and this would also apply in most other patients with a UTI, as much as possible, it should not be present for more than 2 days. 48 hours is currently our maximum, unless there is a pressing need, or if the doctor can justify why he wants a catheter placed for longer than 48 hours, then it should be documented as much as possible, though. Otherwise, they should be removed as soon as they are no longer needed. So therefore, part of your nursing care is, of course, to assess for the indication of the Foley catheter every shift, Okay, so ask yourself, does the patient still need this? If not, then it shouldn't be left in there anymore. This is kind of redundant. We already mentioned this under pyelonephritis, but here it is again. Risk factors involve females, manifestations, we already mentioned them also earlier. So here's the painful urination, there's urinary frequency, urgency, right? And then signs and symptoms, of course, of urinary tract infection. Diagnosis, we already mentioned earlier, we get a urine sample for urinalysis and also urine culture. Treatment here, same antibiotics. We also use again phenazopyridine, so that's pyridium for the bladder pain or bladder spasms. Take note, okay, pyridium is not an antibiotic. So here are your antibiotics. We have Bactrim, Cipro. This one's only for the bladder pain. Okay, so here to decrease the dysuria, which is your painful urination, frequency and urgency. Complications we already mentioned. So pyelonephritis, acute pyelonephritis can result if the patient has an untreated or undertreated UTI. Or in severe cases, the infection can turn into an abscess in the kidney. Okay, here's something not mentioned under acute pyelonephritis. There's a illustration here of a cystocele. So cystocele is also called bladder prolapse. So here's your normal physiologic structures, anatomy. And here is a prolapsed bladder. So obviously the wall here separating the bladder from the vagina is weakened over here. So the wall weakened, so therefore the bladder prolapsed into the vagina. So that's one of the causes. So they'll have to fix that, otherwise you'll have frequent urinary tract infections because now you have a pocket right here. And the prolapse part of the bladder, there will be incomplete urine emptying as a result. So again, if you have urinary retention there, then that will cause frequent UTI formation. Here are signs and symptoms of the UTI again. Or not only in females, we have here the prostate. So obviously here, the patient's prostate enlarged and therefore will obstruct urine flow. So it squeezes the neck right here. So that will block the urethra, causing urinary retention and of course, UTI. And you already know that enlarged prostate is a cause of post-renal kidney injury as well. And here's nursing management. So it's not really any different again. So same thing as you did for acute pyelonephritis. Okay, we have antibiotics, pyridium, and teaching. Again, increasing fluids, the importance of good perineal care here, good habits of urinating before and after sexual activity, and of course proper hygiene. Last one is kidney stones. So there are several causes of kidney stones. We just finished hyperparathyroidism, so that one leads to hypercalcemia. That's one of the causes of formation of kidney stones. There are of course other causes, because the patient doesn't just develop calcium stones, there can also be uric acid. Okay, so here are other types of stones that can form. And they can form anywhere along the urinary tract, either the lower and the upper urinary tract. Regardless of where it is, they have the potential to obstruct urine flow, and if it's serious enough, then it will cause hydronephrosis or presence of urine in the kidneys. Now the urine backs up all the way up, so you'll have a hydrourethra. So let's say this is your kidney, right? So if you have, and this is the bladder, so if you have either stones here, 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 for instance, the urine, the same thing occurs. There will be obstruction of urine flow. So first you'll have a what's called a hydrourethra, meaning the ureters will enlarge because they're distended now, full of urine, and then eventually the urine will now go back into the kidneys, causing hydronephrosis. And this is serious because unless the urine is removed or drained from the kidneys, then it will lead to chronic kidney disease. Same thing here. So this is called a hydrourethra. Okay, wherein the urine is distending the ureters. And this, and of course, is hydronephrosis. So therefore, before this one and this one occurs, there has to be obstruction of urine flow. The obstruction can be anywhere in the lower or in the upper urinary tract. So here it is. So you have a kidney stone, and here is obviously enlarged ureter. So this is now called a hydrourethra, and once it reaches the kidney, then you have hydronephrosis. Medical management. This is not managed like a UTI, although the patient can develop a UTI, but this one usually is manage either invasively or non-invasively. To diagnose, we have to visualize the urinary tract, so you can get that from a simple x-ray of the kidneys, ureters, and bladder, or if it's not giving you a good picture, then the doctor may opt for a CAT scan. Treatment, the goal, of course, is to get rid of the stone. There are surgical managements here. So a doctor can do either a cystoscopy, which is the old-fashioned putting in a scope, flexible long scope through the urethra all the way to the ureters to remove the kidneys. That's the traditional way. Now we have modern non-invasive ways to remove stones. We have we can use shock waves now. We also have lasers, or I think they call it green light. I'm not sure, but they can crush stones now using shock waves or even laser, okay, in order to break them up into tiny pieces, and then the patient can just pass them through the urine. Of course, in order to confirm that they passed it, then we have to strain the urine. So after the procedure, the patient will have to be using a strainer. So when they pee into a urinal, male or female, the urine must be strained to look at to look for the presence of the past stone. The treatment here are, of course, let's say you have calcium stones, for instance, then you will be given medications to lower your calcium levels. Others, if it's caused by enlarged bladder, for instance, then there's tamsulosin here or Flomax. All right, so these are used other medications like here. These are antihypertensives, doxazosin and tarazosin. These are used not for high blood pressure, but rather because these are vasodilators. They can also be used to relax the ureters, which are smooth muscles. So this is your the instrument used for cystoscopy. And as the same as in module one, so this obviously kidney stones are causes of post renal kidney injury. This is a nephroscope. If the kidney stones are higher up on the kidneys, so instead of going through the bladder, then they can go straight to the kidneys here using a nephroscope. This can also be the procedure used to put in a nephrostomy tube. Here are illustrations for the shockwave therapy. So they use shockwaves to crush the stones, making them easier to pass. Please read this safety alert here. Nursing management, obviously you assess for the signs of kidney stone, and actions of course are pain management and then strain the urine. Others are symptomatic, let's say to control the nausea, vomiting, and these medications were already mentioned earlier to aid in stone passage. Increase fluids unless otherwise the patient develops ESK, kidney failure, then we will have to restrict fluids. Otherwise, and encourage fluids to facilitate passage of the stone. And of course, once every time they urinate, they have to be strained for the presence of the stone. Of course, if there is severe obstruction because of the size of the stone, which will obstruct the bladder and urine flow, then we'll need a urinary catheter, a large gauge, large size urinary catheter. And that's it. The rest of these are, again, the same as before, so look for signs of infection. And then for teaching the patient to avoid kidney stones in the future, these are your instructions. All right, and that should be it. Let me see. All right, that's the end of exam 3.